Let's talk about identity. Hey, everyone. Welcome back to the podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. In today's podcast, you'll notice we have a different look. I have worked over a decade on YouTube, always struggling with my identity and how to express myself on this platform in an authentic but sort of brandy way, and I've just completely failed. I actually think that this was the last step in fulfilling my identity as a human that I needed to complete in order to feel truly fulfilled, I suppose. So I'm excited to talk about that with you today. And okay, so I'm very excited about this and trying to explain this. What we're going to do now, okay, is every week when we do the podcast, I am going to share some of my favorite teas with you. As many of you guys know, I am Chaldean, and that means, I guess, well, my people are from Iraq. That's really what that means. And then it means that we have traditions like having chai every night, tea, to come together as a family, to cleanse our palate, and just to feel grounded. So today I am drinking a tea called, what is it? Hold on. Here we go. So it's called Wildflower Tea. It's very pretty. It comes in a canister. And for those of you listening on Spotify, thank you so much for being here. For those of you on Patreon, thank you so much. And then, of course, for those of you watching on YouTube, you'll see in front of me is a teapot, some cups. I've got my tea right here. I've got the Wildflower Tea that is brewed. It is from Woodland Herbal. I'm not sponsored or anything. I actually struggled with how to source my teas, and I decided to do a mixture of just organically finding them and buying them, and of course going on Etsy. So that is a company on Etsy. I'm not sponsored. Here we go. We're going to try the tea out together. It is a dark green color, and it smells like a like a chamomile chai or chamomile tea. Ooh, exactly what I wanted it to be. Kind of like a cross of green and chamomile tea. Really good. Highly recommend. And now that I've done that, and now that I have tea with me, oh my gosh, let's jump into it. So what I have here for you guys is my little notebook, and I wrote some notes out, and I'm hoping that I can convey to you what identity means to me, because I know in the political sphere, in the philosophy sphere, identity is really complicated and nuanced and convoluted and all the things. So it can be really difficult to sort of convey that to the masses and have them understand it. So I fully expect some people not to understand me and then some people to understand me. Either way, I hope this episode is enjoyable. Okay. Also, I will be taking lots of breaths. I'm a smoker. I smoke a lot of weed. And so even I have to admit, right, it's impacting my lungs, but, you know, girl likes what she likes. So I've been practicing just my, like, deep breathing. Also, as many of you guys know, I have a couple of brothers staying with me, and it is a joyous thing to have family around. But if you hear a lot of ruckus in the background, we all work from home. So there's a lot of, you know, just loudness, which is really beautiful. It's beautiful to start off the day with family, start off my day drinking coffee and maybe having breakfast. It's really beautiful, and so much of how I connect to my family is related to identity, right? Okay. So keep that in mind as we go along here. August 6th, 2000, I had my first kiss. It was a peck on the lips, and it was from my next door neighbor. This was the first moment in my life when I realized, like, oh, I'm a woman, and this means something to me coming from a boy. And it's the boy that it had to have been, because he was the only one in the neighborhood I was either not related to and felt safe with. So he was my next door neighbor. We still see each other now. It's been over 20 years of friendship. He still lives in the same house he lived in when I lived in that old neighborhood. So until I was about 15, I was homeschooled in Orange County, California. And then my parents moved us to the country and we went to public school. So for 2 years of my high school life, I experienced public school. I graduated early in the year 2007. And growing up for me was really wonderful, truly. A lot of challenges along the way. But before 15, when I was still in Orange County, a lot of it was really innocent and easy and fun. But there were questions of identity. There were moments and memories that stayed with me that impacted me in terms of how I see myself. The instance in which I got my first peck was followed by all my brothers, older too, lecturing that boy about boundaries, and that boy getting a talking to when we were about, I don't know how old I must have been, maybe like 11, 10 or something like that. I'm born in 89. So here I am just having this really innocent moment, and it was truly innocent. And of course, he's still got a talking to, and it's sort of interesting because I wonder how it impacted him. I should probably call him and ask. But for me, I just remember feeling liked and enjoying the feeling of being sought after. Surprise. The kiss was a total surprise. Came out of nowhere. And then, of course, after that, what it's like to be a girl and to watch people get lectured on your behalf. And in some ways, it makes you feel special. And then in other ways, it makes you feel like a villain. There were a lot of instances in my life where I think light slut shaming was happening in terms of when boys were into me, there would always be a, what did you do to make them interested? Which was interesting because I was homeschooled before I went to public school. And I was one of those homeschool girls who I dressed like in all boys' clothes. And a big reason for that was because I'm a curvy person. And I liked being one of the boys better than I liked being one of the girls when I was younger. So I used to wear all my brother's clothes. And a lot of the girls would ask me why. And I would say it's because I was trying to be modest. And in some ways, that was true. Like, I was trying to avoid people. I was trying to avoid people looking at me like I was a girl. Because when I was growing up, you were either a girly girl or a tomboy. And if you were a tomboy, you could hang with the boys. And I liked hanging in with the boys. I liked being able to keep up with them. And I still kind of do. And by kind, I mean a lot do. I do like it. And I'm always the last person, but you know what I'm saying. I like to hang out and I like to be a part of it. Probably because I have eight brothers. And I struggled a lot with how I saw myself as a girl and how I saw myself as a person. I mean, I used to call into Radio Disney when I was a kid. I've won skateboards and backpacks. Cara Beth Burnside, like, taught me how to, you know, how to skateboard, how to own myself. I guess I went to this all-girls skating event, and it was so cool just interacting with these people and feeling really strongly connected to being a woman. But then on the same front, feeling like I identified a lot with the boys. So recently, I'm sure you guys have heard that Billie Eilish was in the news, and Billie transformed her identity, her look, and people feel conflicted about it. And Billie, for me, okay, so I listen to Billie's music. I'm not listening to her currently, but a while back I was listening to a lot of Billie. And so I've been watching her career and trying to figure out how she's going to navigate her new image and growing into an adult and being a curvy girl, because she, you know, she's got some poundage on her. She's a bigger girl in terms of, like, in comparison to like a Kendall Jenner, who's a Victoria's Secret model and a toothpick. You know what I mean? It's like a very different body type. She looked very Marilyn Monroe in this cover shoot she did. But the thing that was interesting was that she, according to the article, or at least what I've read from it, right, that she wants to experience being a woman now, which is different. And I know Billie was also homeschooled, so I wonder if she struggled with the same thing I did, which was being taken seriously because you weren't one of those girls, but also knowing deep down that you still wanted to feel attractive and be pretty. And honestly, if we're being frank, I think we need to acknowledge that sexuality and objectification is a big part of feeling attractive. And I know it's hard to balance those things with this idea of, like, feminism or women's lib. And I know that's why a lot of us struggle with how to come to peace with our identities. Are we the slut? Are we the Mary Magdalene? Are we the Mother Mary? Are we the pure girl? Are we the virgin? Am I the knight? Am I, you know, the villain? Am I the lover? Am I the father? Am I, you know, what are we? So when I look at Billie, and I know a lot of you wanted me to talk about Billie, when I look at her as somebody on a complete journey, somebody who's young, somebody who's lived a very different life than the average American kid, somebody who has an experience with her parents being in the industry and her coming into music, like her trying to make her own identity. This is all going to be a journey, and it's not going to be smooth. I do think she's going to have an interesting time about it. And I don't know what kind of girl she is yet. I don't even know if she's going to like being girly girl for a while. Maybe she won't. Maybe she'll go back to being sort of a tomboy. But either way, she's going to probably go through a lot of different identities. And I think you just need to, like, let her do her thing. I know a lot of people feel like she is them, but she is not you. So many times the fans become the stands. They become the poison because they forget, like, this parasocial relationship that's coming in. It's your identity is not rooted in who Billie is. Billie's identity shouldn't be rooted in who you are. You guys are two different people. You happen to enjoy her music. Don't take it too far, right? And this is a struggle. This is something I've struggled with as a content creator my whole time here. Is I've had a stalker. I've had issues. I've had people overstep. I've had women ask me, do I have your consent to convince you to go out with me? Like, no, I said no. I deal with people all the time who, you know, admire my work, but maybe take it to the wrong place. Or maybe they just assume who I am and they have no idea. It's complicated, right? Because when you're watching someone, I get it. You feel like, wow, if this person and I met, we'd be best friends. But the truth is that that's not always the case, and that's not always how it goes, because you're only meeting them in a certain time and place, a certain mood. As an example, in the 1971 film Carnal Knowledge, I just recently watched it with a friend. Art Garfunkel and Candace Bergen are in a scene where they're flirting and talking, and they're having this cute banter about, like, who are we really? Are we the people when we're in school, in front of our parents, at work, when we're asleep, when we're in the shower, when we're alone? Who is our most self? And our identity is so scrambled in the States because for a long time, your identity could be your job. It could be your education level. It could be your status in relation to your family. But sometimes people would choose like one, like, this is my identity. And then everything else was a byproduct of that. But for some of us, it's more mood-based. I know for myself, I think I most identify with whatever headspace I'm in for the day or whatever is my ultimate focus. You know, when my sister-in-law is taking care of her kids, maybe she's in mother headspace. But she also has an education in dirt and nutrients and plants and all these things. So maybe when she's doing that kind of work and not focusing on the kids, she's whatever that's officially called. But it's an interesting thing to try to, you know, ask yourself the question, like, what are we, when are we, and what are we experiencing? And is there a place we come to where our identity is solidified and consistent? Okay, so let me see. I realized with myself, if I'm being completely frank, hold on, let me take a swig of this tea. P.S. Totally love it. Okay, so I realized for myself, and I've told you guys this before, sit in your room, isolated from everything, and examine the self. Who are you? What are you? What are you down to your core? When I am the most myself, I am completely alone. So this is something I've recently had to admit to myself, because I am a romantic. I have this idea of being with a partner who, like, cuts me open and examines every part of me and vice versa. Somebody that I know so well, I know them like I know myself. But because I know, based off of my own life experience and journey, that even I at times can't know myself fully, that the person I'm dating can't also know me fully. They can just sometimes see parts of me that I can't see at the time, but it's never fully, because we're always growing in movement. So it begs the question, can we ever have relationships that are completely honest and transparent, and should we? And then, of course, how does that help us identify what kind of partners we are? Because for me, I think of myself and identify myself as a partner who is honest and transparent and forthcoming and trusting. But the truth is that all those things have to be earned over time, and then we have to have the right communication, and then so on and so forth. But when I am most alone, I am most myself. The other day I was taking a bath and I have the lights off. I love to bathe in the dark. I have my BTS running in the background. Yes, ladies, I'm still on BTS. I have a video coming up about it. Gentlemen, ladies, people, I can't help it. I love it so much. Not ashamed. Love pop music. Highly recommend pop music. I'm a 90s baby. Without pop music, I mean, what would the world be like? So I'm listening to BTS. I'm in the bath and I'm having a moment where I'm dancing with the music. I dance a lot in the shower. So I'm dancing in my bathtub and I'm moving with the music, and I pause and I imagine I have a partner and they walk through the door and they see me in this headspace and they're like, what are you doing? And I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing, but it might look weird. And I realize in that moment, oh my gosh, I'm so weird when I'm alone. And I want to be that weird in front of my partner. But I think even though I want to be that weird in front of my partner, I really can't be. I don't think I have it in me, which is so interesting. Because I have this really strong idea that I'm transparent and that I want to share everything with my partner and that I want to be able to express all these things to them. But if I'm most myself when I'm alone, then what does that mean for my future partnerships? I actually think it's pretty reasonable to have a boundary, to have a moment where maybe, you know, maybe we're not completely always with each other at every point, and maybe that's okay. All right, hold on. I'm going to pour some more tea into my cup because I need some warmth. Oh my goodness, love. Also, I'm using this coaster. It's so beautiful. I actually got it in North Carolina when I was traveling. Oh my gosh, I saw so many states and they were all so beautiful. Okay, so identity. I think every person has an alone self, right? I think that's pretty clear that when we're alone, we all have this intimate self that we interact with. Now, what's interesting is that I do think this right here, that ability to have an alone self, is proof that we are truly human, a living, thinking human with an understanding that we are a living entity solo from the world, sort of like a Randian concept of just isolation of the individual, but of course, not so intense as Rand and a little bit more, we are still a part of a community. So I think the intimacy, that's the word I have like right here that sticks out to me on my notebook. It says, I think what makes humans truly human is how intimate we can get with ourselves and how shallow we can observe ourselves. So I was thinking about the difference between intimacy and shallowness in relation to identity and the self. And it's interesting because in some ways we think the most intimate understanding of ourselves is like our gender, as an example. Like I always say my core self is that I'm a woman. But in some ways that is the most shallow observation of what I am as a human, because that's the most obvious. Yeah, duh, you're a woman. Like I can look at you and say like, yeah, dude, you're a woman. So it's like a pretty shallow way to identify myself. And yet it's the most intimate one I have. And I think that's very interesting, especially on this channel where we're critical of self-identifications and we're critical of sort of like the lax exploration into gender that people are having. Because I think when we think identity is simple, we lose ourselves in the madness of it, because identity is a serious it's a serious concept in a human brain. It's everything that we are. It's why I'm hesitant to like go around saying everyone has to believe my truth, because I think of like the hyper religious people that are actually really happy in religion, and that if I went to them and said God isn't real and they somehow decided, oh, that must be true, they could have like a midlife crisis. And yes, we're not responsible for people's midlife crises in these ways, of course, but I, Brittany, as a human, think it's unnecessary to pop the bubbles of the twos just because I want them to, because there's no incentive. Like I don't need people to know more than they know. Like if somebody really believes in aliens and it really suits them, as ridiculous as I think it is, I think it's not really my place to sort of dismantle that person's belief. Okay, so when I was 14, a year before I left Orange County to the country to go to public school, I was still homeschooled, but I went to a Catholic church because I was born and raised Catholic. We're Middle Eastern Iraq from the Catholics from Iraq. And I was born and raised in California, and in Orange County, there's this really big Catholic church, and I used to go to that church, and I was in the confirmation program. You have to do it for 2 years in your teens, depending on what part of Catholicism you're practicing. And I was, you know, really into my faith at the time, struggling still with my sexuality, but very, very much in the church. I was like, God's real, God's real, God's real. And I was really trying to find that and solidify that belief. My leaders, my fellow confirmation attendees, everyone just thought I was really silly and dorky. And I was totally that homeschool kid. Like every time in my head, I think I'm not really like those homeschool kids, but I am kind of like that homeschool kid. I'm both. Like I definitely, there was a time in my life when you looked at me and you went, that girl be homeschooled. And then, you know, maybe now in my life, people might not have known that I was homeschooled for most of my life, but your girl was weird. So I went to this retreat, and there was a boy attending this retreat that changed my teen life. And helped me solidify how I saw myself. So during this retreat, there was a time during the weekend where we had these mailboxes all set up and people were supposed to write notes and put it in our mailboxes. And we were supposed to make friends at camp or whatever. And your girl didn't make no friends, because I really am not like normal people. And kids especially know when you're around a kid who's not like normal people. I don't like the same things. I liked like anime at the time, and I still do. And a lot of the kids in Orange County are not like anime buffs. You know what I mean? They're like, they're just not those kids. And this in particular group of kids that went there, a portion of them went to the local high school that was for rich kids. And my friend went there because she got, you know, she was born on the school district line, and that's the school she went to. And so we had some connections to this boy who was there. His name was EB. I'm going to call him EB. That's not his name, but, you know, I'm going to call him EB. And EB was there. And the whole time I knew he was there, I was thinking, I wish I could talk to him. Like, I wish we could have an interaction, but I'm just a loser and I'm an anime nerd. And, you know, there's like, he's not going to want to talk to me. And of course, the whole weekend, I wasn't making friends and no one was talking to me. And I just like, I didn't even think about it. To be honest, it felt hurtful and I felt bored and I wanted to go home. But I didn't feel bullied. I just like, it made sense. I'm used to it. I literally showed up as Hermione Granger one time to a Halloween party with these kids. And true to Hermione Granger, I look like Hermione Granger. I look like a nerd. And so everyone, like, I was not one of those girls who was like a sexy Hermione Granger. I was just Hermione Granger. Like, you know what I'm saying? So this weekend comes up and everyone's supposed to give the letters and the counselors notice that nobody's put a letter in my mailbox. And they feel really bad for me. And I know they feel bad for me because I just watch people. I spend my whole life watching people and I saw them talking and pointing to me and I knew they were saying because I could overhear some of them. And I saw them walk up to EB and I saw them explain to EB that like, hey, no one's like putting any letters in her box. What do we do? And EB took it upon himself to put letters in my box and to make friends with me that weekend. Now to understand EB, so EB's mother was also a teacher at the high school he went to and my friend went to. So my friend knows his family knows our family because we went to the same church. So in this small town of Little Orange County in Orange, we were all connected enough to kind of know each other. EB spent that weekend with me being so nice and reaching out. And I remember we were sitting on a carpet, you know, knee to knee, face to face. Guys, it felt like an anime. It felt like an anime show where, like, the loser girl who's just too awkward for anyone is, like, talked to by the hottest guy there. And, like, the nice, like, guys, he was the man, you know? And he talked to me and he was so sweet. And he didn't just talk to me because he had to. He was just that kid. And it's crazy when your life turns out to be such a trope, right? Your life turns out to be such an anime. It's like, oh my God. That weekend, I fully realized I'm the weird homeschool kid. Because I was homeschooled my whole life, and until those interactions at 13, 14, I didn't really interact with other kids who like, the girl who is my best friend who is connected to EB by going to school with him, she is just as weird as I am, but looks more normal than I do. But she's just as weird as I am. But she looks more normal than I do. She blends better. So what's funny about that is that up until that point, because I was homeschooled, I just never saw myself as like the weird kid because everyone in homeschooling is kind of weird. Like we're all just so different. And it's cool because our parents often let us choose things that we actually want to do. So I think we end up being pretty big nerds because when humans are allowed to do things they actually are interested in, I think it makes sense that most people are into weird hobbies or video games or anime or something entertaining or something nerdy, books. You know what I mean? I think it makes sense. I think popular culture, the reason I never really loved it was because it didn't feel like anyone was doing anything they really wanted to do. It just felt like a lot of pressure to have like big lips or plastic surgery or do drugs or go party. And every time I hung out with popular culture to do those things, you know, it was dangerous. People don't protect you in those circles. Like I say, if it's approved by the majority, I often don't trust it because they think a majority of people are complacent in their stagnation. Now, later, about a year or two later, I had moved out of Orange County and I was in the country and I was in public school and I was struggling and I had a really hard time in high school. I was bullied out of high school. I was a queer kid. I came out. I was like one of the first people to help start the first GSA in the whole county. Like, it was a lot. I didn't love it. But during those years, I got a phone call from that girl, my best friend, who was connected to EB and found out that EB had died. That he had drowned on his own vomit after a night of partying with his popular friends. He had died in his own pool, asleep on a floaty, vomited, drowned. And his mom had to come home to her kid. Died, like just dead. It was really sad. It was really sad. He really was really loved by the community. And he impacted so many people. So I wonder if EB during his life recognized that he would be so impactful. Or did he go out through his life wondering, like, am I just the hot guy? Like, I wonder. And I think he did. I think he was a person who contemplated his own identity because he was nice to me. I think people who contemplate their own existence tend to be more compassionate, right? And they tend to be people who consider what other people are thinking because I think they consider how they're thinking and feeling. I think we neglect ourselves and therefore we neglect other people. And I think EB is one of my favorite examples of like the popular hot guy who ended up actually being the popular hot guy who was also a good person. And that's how I see him. The truly kind and compassionate hot guy. And I wonder if that's how he'd identify himself. Because I have a feeling that he might have been struggling a little bit before he died, you know? But I don't think it was suicide. I think it was an accident. I think he was in search of his identity and he didn't get to make it out. I don't know how many people in my life have had instances of drinking and driving and drugs and all these things and they didn't die. And they were able to use this as a way to come into their next grown self, their next step in enlightenment, and they got to survive their lesson. But EB didn't. EB died. And so I know a lot of people wanted to identify him as the kid who died on his own vomit, but I can never see him that way. I can't. You know what I mean? Even though that's a very true way of being able to describe in one moment who he was. You know what I mean? All right, let's take a little break and we'll be right back.
Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence?
Me too.
Join us on Patreon for just $1 to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just $1, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks, bye.
And we're back. All right, so in case you guys can't tell, I'm actually like sitting on my floor. I've got this like really nice comfy rug underneath me and these pillows. I have really poor circulation. And I realized when I put up this set, I really wanted a space in my house when I'm working to feel like I'm grounded. And for me, with my poor circulation, this is definitely the way to be. It feels really good. It makes me also feel really young. I notice as I age and my knees hurt and my body hurts, I realize how much I appreciate actually being able to still sit on the floor. Because, girl, let me tell you, certain positions got me aching. Okay, so let's see. I'm reading my notes right now for those of you who are listening on Spotify and cannot see me. Okay, so I wrote down some notes. It said, growing up, I have, like I said, Catholic parents, religious parents, and the way that they teach the hierarchy of importance is God first, family, then kids, wife, meaning, you know what I mean? So the way my dad says it is like, I'm a Catholic, I'm a husband, I'm a father. So my parents would always say to me things like, you know, your mom and I are a team, you guys are your own, you have to leave the nest and be your own people. And that your mother and I will always have each other's back, right? So when, like, there's a disagreement between, like, let's say me and my mom, I know my dad will choose my mom's side, not out of actually agreeing or for, like, promoting an untruth or something like that, but as a way to say that regardless of what we're talking about, don't bring me into this and get between my wife and me, you know? It's about respect. Same with religion. I don't ask my family to ever put me above their religion. I don't ask my dad to put me above my mom. And I wouldn't expect my parents to ask me to put my husband or wife above them when I get married. Because in our family, when you get married, you are really like leaving your family to make a new one with your spouse. And at the same time, because I grew up in a family that's very involved, I also know that the person who's marrying me is marrying into my family. And so there is a form of identity there that brings us all together, right? And it's interesting, I wrote down some notes in terms of like a sexual being versus a non-sexual being, because as a woman myself who's very sexually driven, who's very into sexual art, erotic art, I have an OnlyFans, I am unashamed, I love it so much, it's literally one of the best things that's ever happened to me. I just put out three of my most like proud films that I've ever done. I'm very proud of the work that I do there because for me, it is an opportunity for me to express what's in my head, to dance to specific music, to have a vibe that I'm pushing out into the world. And so for me, this is just a blessing. But I know how it looks to people who look at me. So the way, when it comes to my job, especially on OnlyFans, I really just see myself as like an erotic artist. But I know in some capacity, I'm also just like a sex worker. I think these are different things, though, to a large extent, because sex work traditionally appeals to the client versus I think erotic art allows the artist to appeal to themselves and then find an audience that it appeals to. And that's always been my struggle on YouTube, where the identity of my who I was as a person contradicted a lot of the identity of how I conveyed my channel to the world. So this is a struggle. I don't know how many people have this struggle, right? I don't know if this is just a content creator thing or an online I don't know. But I know in my head I struggle all the time with conveying myself authentically. So the reason I'm very excited about this podcast is because I had this huge epiphany the other day. I was stoned as hell, just like stoned out of my brain, sitting on my bed watching anime, and I had this moment where I was like, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, I just found it. I figured it out. And I was like, wait, I love philosophy. I love storytelling. I love pop culture. And I love tea. Why don't I just combine that energy together? Because if you're like me, you know tea has like an energy, right? Aesthetic has an energy. The plants, everything around me, like I'm trying to set a mood, which I've always failed at as a brander because I'm so many different Britneys. And when it came down to it, I had to specifically like stop the merry-go-round on the Brittany who can work on YouTube. And that Brittany is like the most curious Brittany. Because like some versions of myself is very cynical. I'm like very, but most of my personality is curious. I want to know why. I want to explore these ideas. I know people do too. I know I'm not the only one. I see it on the internet. The biggest complaint on the internet is, why aren't people having the conversations we want to have? And it's because I don't think we know how. How can we have a conversation that we don't know how to have? I have a different set of skills that allows me to have the conversation I can have now, but it only came after all this time. I struggled on YouTube just like everyone else, asking, why aren't people having the conversations that we need to be having? Because I wasn't even having them. Because I was afraid. I was afraid to say things. I was afraid of being identified incorrectly. Recently, I got identified as a anti-vaxxer. And there is a part of me when I dive into the world of the twos that I'm like, oh my God, what? No, what? But obviously, in the world of the fives, and if you guys don't know what I'm talking about my observational philosophy, the levels of how to categorize humans. Like, in the world of the fives, you're not an anti-vaxxer if you don't take vaccines. You're an anti-vaxxer if you literally think vaccines never work, period, are evil, period, are poisonous, period. Like, there has to be a hardcore conspiracy about vaccines for me to call you an anti-vaxxer. For me, not wanting to take a vaccine is just so reasonable that my brain's like, I do not see the issue. If anything, you know what I mean? It. How do I say this? I think in order for people to see me as an anti-vaxxer, they also have to be on the other side of the anti-vax. They have to be like so pro-vax. They think vaccinations are like coke. I don't know. They have to be on the... Because anyone else who hears me talk about vaccines who's not on a hardcore on either side, they're just like, yeah, that makes sense, dude. It doesn't even impact them the same. But the people who have like an identity in the vax or no vax, those people get upset because now I've questioned their own identity. Remember, when we get upset with people, we're upset for a multitude of reasons. But one of them is strongly that we rely on people around us to confirm our reality. So when the person in front of us is like, what does Eminem say? That's an apple. No, it's not. It's a peach. It's like we are all calling it an apple. Some people are calling it a peach. Maybe someone calls it a unicorn. When we're observing what we're observing, we use our neighbors and friends around us to, again, confirm our reality. So you can imagine, right, that a lot of when we criticize or are critical of identity, a lot of it does trigger people because what we're really criticizing is their sense of reality. Okay, let me see. Oh, okay. So my friend is a professional ballerina. That's what she does. And she really dances, like, you know, for a company. She does, you know, COVID's kind of messed everybody up. But she talks about how in the world of the ballet, you have two deaths. You have the first death you have when you first retire out of ballet. And then you have the second death when you retire out of your second career. And I've seen it happen. Like, I'm watching it happen to my friend. I'm seeing how things go go forward. And it is difficult. You know, she's been really lucky to dance as long as she has. She's got a really great career. She's a beautiful dancer. I just saw her perform last year. It was made me cry. She's so beautiful when she dances. And it's crazy because so much of her identity is a ballerina. Like, she chose this career when she was a kid. Her parents gave her all the options in the world. And she's like, I want to dance. And she did. She's done it for a decade plus. Like, she's danced. She did what she wanted with her career. Is she super famous? No. Is she living a modest life? Yes. She and I are really the same person. We did the same things with our careers. We chose gig jobs. We chose jobs in the arts, basically. We chose jobs with little to no money, or yes, the possibility of lots of money, but not really. Like, maybe, depending on how you do it. And I see it happening to her, where her identity is shifting because she will eventually shift out of dance. And I'm waiting for that to sort of happen to me, possibly, right? Because my career as well is dependent on YouTube existing and OnlyFans existing and people listening to podcasts. I haven't made like Joe Rogan money where I'm good no matter what happens. I'm not famous enough to carry an audience into my 60s. You know, I need to get to the point where this can be a viable choice. Do you guys know when I was younger, I wanted to be a talk radio host? I had this idea that I would be the next Rush Limbaugh or Sean Hannity, because I was a conservative at the time, and then Tammy Bruce and all these things. Like, I would be this queer voice for people in conservatism. Of course, I moved out of conservatism and now I'm just like a basic old let people do what they're going to do kind of person. But it is one of those things where so much of my identity got reformed to look the same as I got older. Guys, I basically want to be a podcaster. I want to be a YouTuber, right? That's what I've been doing. I want to make enough money, though, that it's like a real business long term. And that's like, that's a different game. I haven't been playing that game. I haven't really been playing the long game. My identity has been rooted in my authenticity, and I hadn't been able to balance money making with authenticity. As many of you know, I don't love social media. I think it is a toxic and unproductive place, but it also will help me move forward in my career. And I'm going to be real. I want to do this full time. So, and even though I do it full time, I want to do it into retirement. So help me out here. If you want, I'm on Instagram. If you want, I'm on Twitter. Links down below. The Twitter is 18+. The Instagram is PG. Say it with me. Instagram PG, Twitter 18+. This way I can still do what I want to do and be authentic. And this way you guys can have a choice. Do you want to see me 18+ OnlyFans fun stuff Twitter? Or do you want to see me PG Instagram, things you can show your mom? Basically, the pictures I post on Instagram, I'm trying to think, will my mom think this picture is cute? Because I am trying to appeal to the rules of Instagram on Instagram, and I'm trying to utilize the leeway we have and loopholes we have on Twitter. So please join me there if you want. I have struggled so much with this social media stuff. I've struggled so much with how to identify myself online and how to come across as an authentic person and not a brand. But the truth is like, this is a job. So I have to treat it like a job, but I also want to treat it as an opportunity for me to express myself. This is my one opportunity to talk to the world, to actually have people hear me. Like, what a gift, what a blessing to be able to say something and have people hear me. I always thought, you know, I wonder what it's like to be president, to say something and have almost everyone in the world hear it. Well, I want a chance to be that person, that when I say things, I'm aware that they could impact the world. So I'm hoping that you guys can help me utilize social media in that way without drowning in it. I'm not going to be obsessed with it. I won't be responding to, trolls or anything like that. I just want to have fun, and I want it to be kind of a healthy social media page. So fingers crossed here. Many of us struggle. We don't even have to be anti-capitalism to struggle with being authentic. So many of my friends on YouTube, so many people I've met have such a different personality behind the camera because they almost have to sometimes for mental health, separate the worlds. And then other times it's just a struggle with identity. Remember, as you watch Billy and you watch Demi and you watch all these people go through their identities and changing and shifting, that they're experiencing their life the way they know it and they're using the information they have. Highly recommend Nora. She's Gotta Have It? Is that what it's called? It's really good. It's on Netflix. It's a remake. But Nora is a really good example of a woman who's an artist who goes through the trials and tribulations of identity in terms of especially romantic partnerships. But who am I and who do I attract and who am I dating? All of these things are different versions of identity, from your ethnicity to your gender to your sex and all these things. And so we have to decide who is the core self we are when we're alone, because I think that's your most honest self. And then who are we when we're with people? Because Brittany in a relationship is very different than Brittany when she's single, or Brittany when she has a lover, or Brittany when she has a fuck buddy. Like, these things are very different Brittanys, because I'm the kind of human that puts everything in categories. Obviously, I literally created an observational observational philosophy about categorization. Like, I love putting humans in boxes and still planning for the gray. So you'll notice, right, I try to move with intention because I want my life to match the person that I see myself as. And in order to do that, I have to do the things I've been working out lately. And I see a huge difference in everything, my body, my energy, my flow, my feel. And I see a change in my body specifically. Like, it's very important for me to see results. And I've told myself to be very patient through this process. I don't like working out. It's not very much fun for me, but it is something I want to do. One, to keep up with my future kids. I'm going to be an old mom. And two, to help me with my job. Getting in shape and staying in shape will help me excel on OnlyFans. And because I identify as somebody who's good at my job, I should be good at my job. I'm okay at my job by my own standard, like I make a living, but I want to be really good at my job, which means I have to actually put in the work and I have to make some sacrifices. Most of those sacrifices related to, I think, time mostly, and I need to do this before I become a mother. So I'm trying to plan for the future while keeping true to my identity, while making a living and doing all these things. This took me so long to figure out. I had this idea when I was younger that I would find this. I figured this all out by my mid-20s, because when I was a teenager at 15, 25 was an adult. And now that I'm 31, about to be 32 in a week, like the 14th is my birthday, I'm going to be 32. Like, I'm not where I thought I was going to be at 25, but I'm also way ahead of where I could have been if I had stayed stagnant. If I had stayed stagnant, I would have messed my whole plan up, my whole dream up. I wouldn't have attained anything that I had wanted to, because I would have failed myself. Pushing myself has given me results. I recently read an article about a woman who said she had underestimated how much exercise would impact her and how much she appreciates that it's really attributed to her health overall. I understand that we're living in a country that has a lot of shaming and a lot of people feel attacked. But I also know and believe that we're evolved creatures, that we have things about us that just need to be had, like exercise and health and all that stuff, to be even functional. So if you're feeling lost, if you're feeling like you don't know your identity, if you're feeling insane, pause, take a breath. Are you at least doing the basics? If you're not doing the basics, feeding yourself, clothing yourself, making sure you're sleeping and getting water, then you're not going to have the right information to actually find the answer you want. So many of my friends are being diagnosed with like depression and anxiety in the same way that I was. And I had situational depression. And I have a podcast coming on depression coming up. We're going to do depression next, and then we're going to do narcissism. It's very important, but it's important that you guys have this information too, because when we talk about those things, you have to have the foundation of your identity. So think about your identity in terms of these things, right? Like, all my friends are being diagnosed with depression and anxiety. And they're like, you know, yes, some of it is COVID related and environmentally related. And some of it might be chemical, but to know the difference is the key. Some people, it was chemical. Some people, it was environmental. But I think often, because psychiatrists and therapists are just people, they get tired and they misdiagnose people. Get a second and third opinion. That's what I did. Just make sure, because if you're tackling a problem that isn't there, you're not going to move forward in your life. Remember, yes, we rely on our community members to help us confirm our realities, but we also have to rely on ourselves, because sometimes everyone can be wrong around you. And then sometimes everyone is trying to help you and you should listen. This is a very hard line to balance. This is a very hard thing, because they both involve being aware of your ego and seeking humility to listen and to be prideful enough to stand up for yourself. So many times I've seen people stand up for themselves, but it's been, you can tell it's out of trauma. You know what I mean? It's like even me, when I was in my 20s, I had a breakup and I went, I'm an independent woman. I don't need no man. Fuck it. And then now I'm like, okay, I'm done being angry and petty. Obviously, like, I want to fall in love and have kids like everyone else, right? Or like everyone who wants to do that. And obviously I do need a man or a woman or somebody, But the truth is that I am independent now. That I've made a life for myself that's so good that if this is the way it is forever, like, I'm going to be really happy. I'm going to be really joyful. If I find a partner, great. Fantastic. Got the dream life, you know? But my identity is rooted in my most core humanity. So it's not my job, because I don't know if I could call myself a content creator, a podcaster, a YouTuber, an OnlyFans girl. Like, I don't know what to call myself, except that it's not important enough for me to worry about it. I'm a professional conversationalist, right? I'm a human who has a job talking. I'm okay with all of those identities. They're not important to me. My job isn't important to me. I love my job. But people seeing me as my job just, like, does not matter to me. It might in terms of branding, which I think is important to recognize, but personally, it doesn't impact me. When I think about my sexual orientation, other people's opinions of it doesn't impact me or bother me. I'm bisexual. I know what I am. Been in love with boys and girls since I was a kid. Not worried about it. Who I fall in love with is who I fall in love with. Some people might take my bisexuality as, like, a political statement, or might say the way you identify or talk about the way you love people is discriminatory against other people, or maybe people will feel a certain way, or maybe people will feel threatened. But either way, it still doesn't impact how I think of my own sexuality. I don't think about it anymore, and I don't need my community to confirm my identity and my sexual orientation. I already got it down. And then, of course, like, in my gender and my sex, like, I don't need people to confirm it. I am a woman. I know I'm a woman. You know what I mean? I'm good. There are so many other examples I could use, but ultimately, you need to find a balance between allowing other people to confirm or deny your reality and making sure that you can confirm and identify your reality in your own head. Okay, hold on. Let me see. Okay, cool. So those were basically the notes that I took. But I just want to talk to you guys for a second, okay? Let me make sure I'm good on time. I'm doing really good. I cannot explain to you how hard life was a few years ago and how much better it is now. I cannot explain to you how I feel like I've taken on this army of depression and borderline and I feel triumphant. I feel really good, like I'm on top of the world. And it's so funny because I'm not living the life I thought I would be living when I reached my ultimate happiness, but I'm so grateful for the way that it turned out that I'm just so content, right? I still struggle because I'm human. I struggle with everything that is hurtful or painful. I struggle with things that make me sad. I struggle with everyday realities. I check the news. I feel sad. I'm a person. You're a person. We're all going to observe our realities to the best of our abilities. And ultimately, how we think of our identities is what I think allows us to go down a particular path. If you're in a world of the two and you live in a specific bubble that tells you the only reality is atheism and God never even existed, then you wouldn't have the ability to explore the spiritual side of your existence and to think about ancient religions or to think about modern religions in a way that could help you. If you're born into a religious home that tells you God exists and that gay people don't, and then you go out into the world and never meet a gay person, you might not know there's gay people around or that people are in the closet. And then finally you meet a gay person and your whole reality is shattered, right? That's a struggle. These things are a struggle. As much as we can be petty and mock and say it's 2021, everyone should be up to date with it, what's cool, we are all raised in whatever bubbles we're in. The reason in my observational philosophy that I say that number twos live in bubbles is because they are like bubbles of reality, but they're poppable. A bubble is a thing that makes you feel safe and warm and, you know, isolated, but can easily be popped because all it takes is a moment of your brain processing reality differently for you to never be able to go back. It's like I always say the ABCs, you either know the ABCs or you don't know the ABCs. You cannot not know if you know the ABCs. Like, you either know them or you don't know them. You know, and you can't unknow them. And so it's one of those things where once you've popped a bubble, you can pop lots of them and there are lots to pop and there's always more to see. But ultimately, there is you as a human in your body alone in a room, you as a neighbor, you as a parent, you as a social, you know, X, Y, and Z. And then there's you in relation to, how do I say this? There's the you in relation to the you. So there's the you now in relation to the you of the past and the you of the future. So we're always having conversations with ourselves. I just shared on the community tab on YouTube Jordan Peterson versus Jordan Peterson. And that's how it feels when I'm talking to myself. I am hypercritical of my own work. I very much sit at home and I'm like, I try to debunk my own work. Last night we did a live show on Patreon and it was so nice. It was great. And I did calls and you guys called in. P.S. Join us for $1 on Patreon. You get live shows, phone calls. It's great. Every other Tuesday. And so I was on it and one of you called up and we talked about, you asked a question and I was about to answer the question, but then I stopped because as I was about to answer the question, I debunked my own answer in my own head. And that's what I'm doing. I'm always trying to debunk my own ideas in my head because I want to make sure that I find truth. I'm indifferent to the truth. I'm not holding on to any particular view of myself that has to stay there. I'm okay with letting go of the many versions of myself that I see myself as. And I think that's kind of the key. I wasn't like that before. Before, I was like, I'm not letting go of this identity. I'm not letting go of this belief. I'm not letting go. I'm not letting go. I'm not letting go. And the thing is that once I let go, I think that's what they mean when they say give it to God or let the universe handle it. It's like once I let go, I went on a journey that I just couldn't go on before because I was holding on. It's like literally I was holding on to my own weight. My own, I enslaved myself. And I think that's why I have such a big or large or... I'm sorry. I think that's why I have such a strong opinion about consent and about how consenting adults can consent to toxicity. And carnal knowledge, it really is, if you guys want an idea of what I see a toxic relationship as, it's like these people in these relationships. But I also don't see anyone in this movie as like abusive. Because in my head, I'm like, yeah, a toxic relationship usually involves two people who are in denial of who they are or are trying to make things work that don't fit. Because for me, I think toxicity is a part of the growing experience. I think sometimes we fall in love with toxic people. Sometimes we are toxic. I think it just is what it is. But I think culture has made it where they see the T word and they think it means a person is good or bad. But I think good people can be toxic. And if good people can be toxic, toxicity itself isn't really the issue. It's a part of life. I think what we really need to be cautious about is how we're impacting the people in our circle. Like I absolutely have consented to being in toxic relationships and I don't like it when people tell me that I was in an abusive relationship. It really bothers me because it just didn't work out that way for me. And it's kind of a slap in the face to women who have been abused or men who have been abused because it means that you guys are making a victim out of someone who doesn't see themselves that way and ignoring the people who are really asking for help. Instead of worrying about people who are misidentifying whether or not they're abused or not, maybe just try to reach out to the people who are being abused. Because right now they're asking for your help and they need you. You know what I mean? So I think it's more of a priority thing and also a respect thing. I respect people enough. I respect myself enough to know when I've been in a situation. So the last... How do I say this? The last... most impactful observation of my identity came from whether or not I was a classy person or a trashy person. So this impacts me the most because I see myself as like a classy person who's a little street. So meaning I know I don't have normal table manners. I got kicked out of Cotillion. I got kicked out of nun camp. I am a rebel. I break into places. I know I'm not a lady, but I also know I'm not trash. And trash is subjective. We all have different ideas of what trash looks like. But for me, trash is just like a complete denial of how you're impacting the community. So maybe you're a person who like litters your front yard and I'm like, you're such trash. You can't even honestly like realize how much you're impacting the neighborhood, right? It's for me, it's almost like a blind spot they have that I don't like. So when I was in my toxic relationships, I was trash. There was a part of me that was trying to swim out of the trash. But to be completely honest, the only way I could have dated those people was by being one of them. Even naively, the idea that we were going to have a rough relationship, that we would both help each other out into the next part of our existence in which we would be middle class and like a participant of society and good neighbors and people would see us as real adults. But it wasn't. I really was just like in a shitty relationship or I had shitty friends or I was in shitty environments around other trash people. And I see the difference now, obviously, because I'm older and I'm actually like looking for a house and I'm like decorating my home and I'm buying nice furniture and I'm realizing like, oh, yeah, there is definitely a difference between being trash and like growing up. And I think when you're young, you can really look at yourself for a long time while you're trash and not care. But when you get to a certain age, it kind of like it needs to be an awakening moment. But I struggle with this a lot. it's not just a mixture of classism, because I don't think it's about the dollar amount you have. It's about your behavior. Are you honorable or not honorable? And I want to be an honorable person, and therefore I must act honorably. And I think that's the thing, is we think, and look, the Bible has parables about this. There's stories about this all the time, about the hypocrites of people who espouse morals and being ethical and having all of these I am better than thou concepts or attitudes around them. And then you find out they're a hypocrite. The reason they're a hypocrite is because they try to pretend they're perfect. I'm not perfect. I'm not interested in your perfection. If you come to me and say you're an ultimately perfect person, I'd want to do anything else but talk to you. Because to be completely honest, the only people who think they're perfect are delusional people. And I have a weird patience for people who are delusional enough to believe in tinfoil hats, but less so about a delusion of themselves being perfect. It's just like my pet peeve, ultimate pet peeve. Also, I think because ultimately it is the epitome of stagnation. And it's funny because when I talk and I say this is the Brittany I'm going to be for the rest of my life, people are like, oh, stagnation. This is the personality I'm probably going to have for the rest of my life, right? This is like, I have a goal. I have an interest in investing in a consistent Brittany. It's very different. And I think ultimately we all have these struggles of our worst ways we've identified ourselves. And then the worst part is when you see yourself and someone you hate, you're like, oh Lord Jesus, that's me. I did it, you know? But these things are so important, and I'm excited. I'm joyful. I'm stoked. I'm fucking like, I am ready to really enjoy the next chapter of my life. And I'm so grateful that my 20s were hard. I'm so grateful I had so many different Britneys. I'm so grateful I can start on this chapter. I think I'm really just hearing Joe Rogan's voice in my head, which is like, there's such a blessing to having your career take off when you're in your 30s or 40s. Look at Jordan Peterson. He had it happen later in life, and he struggles. And so I know I'm going to struggle. I know I'm going to have bad days. I know I'm going to feel worthless. So I know that's just a moment I have to get through. And I will make it, and you will make it, and we'll be fine. But you have to do the work. I know it's difficult, and I know you probably don't want to do it, but it's okay. You have to be okay with who you are. I think the Billie Eilish, one last thought on the Billie Eilish thing. I think the Billie Eilish thing stands out to me the most, because there were so many people who had so many ideas of who she was. The fat girl, the tomboy, the homeschool girl, the secret slut. And ultimately, she's the person to remember when we're trying to decide who she is. Because she's in motion, we won't know until she knows. And even then, we might not be able to accept it. And so, if you guys want something that I do, that I'm sure some of you do too, is like, I do follow people's careers. I try to see like what happens, because they're real people and I'm a real person. And if you, like me, want to be a content creator full time, you have to understand that you might one day be her. You might one day be Joe Rogan. You might one day be someone who's in the news, and the news is looking at you, and people are doing stories about you. And you're going to have to be ready to have the whole world identify you and identify you incorrectly. And then you're going to have to handle that. And now regular citizens are having this happen. When people go around calling people Karens or racist or any of these things, yes, it's fun and petty, and sometimes it's true. But it's also very weird that we're living in a time where the internet can identify you and then talk about you. And you don't have an opportunity and are not rewarded for being authentic in this environment. So you are at a standstill. Remember, we do not live in a country where you are safe to truly be your authentic self. If that was true, we would just accept people for who they are, but we don't. You, like me, have an idea of the world that you want. Mine's a little bit more chaotic, maybe, but mine involves ultimately people having choice. And we are all not going to make the same choices, and therefore chaos will ensue. But my identity throughout that chaos does not shift. Because who I am at my core exists in all the worlds in which it can exist, because it already is alive. It's here. If I was born in Iraq, I wouldn't be this Brittany. But I am this Brittany today. And so this Brittany in every situation is always going to start off as this Brittany. And then form based off of her environment. But ultimately, my identity is is rooted in the base foundation of my humanity, and this has no word. It is neither a title of father or mother or brother or sister. It is neither associated with my job nor my income, and it is not associated even with my sex or gender. It's just that core self. Maybe it doesn't have an identifier, and that's why it's difficult. But at least we have things like the Myers-Briggs and 16 personalities test. Highly recommend you guys take it. I love taking it every year. I'm always the commander. And it makes total sense for who I am, if you cannot tell. Thank you for watching. Have a great day. Please check out Spotify. Please check out Patreon and join us for a dollar there. And thank you for making this content possible. I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye. Okay, so I need you guys to do a couple things for me. One, I need you to leave a comment for the algorithm if you can. Two, I want you to tell me what subjects on narcissism and depression you specifically want me to cover, because now that I've set you up with identity, now that we've talked about identity, I want it to carry on to talking about depression and narcissism, because a lot of us equate our depressive episodes or our narcissistic tendencies as a part of our personality, and maybe, sort of, let's talk about it. So next week, okay, in order to make that episode happen, I need you guys to help me in the comment sections down below. And then, of course, thank you for being here. Please check out this latest song by my homie who does the end of the podcast song. She recorded a new one and is letting me use it to coincide with our episode of Identity. She is not yet public, but please leave her a comment in the sections down below. She's just really working on her stuff, and she really wants to one day come out into the world. But, you know, she needs some time to figure herself out and how she wants to identify herself as an artist. All right, guys. Talk to you soon. Bye.
Sometimes I feel like my brain, it does not belong to me. Input, output, calculating it automatically. Do I choose to make the choice, or is the choice I choose simply me reacting? No one knows you better than yourself, they say. Yet I look around for her all day. Sounds like such a promising philosophy. Makes it seem like she's in front of me. Don't tell me to be myself unless you can. Offer me a puzzle piece, a roadmap, or a plan. A way to find myself, find who I really am. Don't tell me less you so. City, I'm chasing it until I can't breathe. Standing straight, acting my age, trying to balance all it. Letting things fall into place without being tempted into complacency.